All right, let's go on to chapter 7 again. So we introduced chapter 7 last time. Integral by substitution. Our book uses W, other books use U. And I showed you at the end of class on Friday how to do a certain definite integral with substitution. I showed you a certain method and said to do it that way in your assignment due today. Today, I want to do another definite integral, and I want to use a different method, still with substitution, but a different process to get the same kind of answer in a different way. And for the assignment due Wednesday, from section 7.1, I want you to do it the second way today. That we talk about today, do that for Wednesday. This way is a bit more confusing for people, but in the big scheme of things, it's actually more important. Let's also pick an example that's a little strange looking, just for the sake of emphasizing that this is an integral related to another integral that you should memorize. Does anybody feel like you know what I'm talking about when I say this integral is related to another integral that should be memorized? Mm-hmm. Close. Make sure to include the plus one.
Oh, 1 plus 1 over x is, if I remember correctly, arctan?
Yep. This integrand is similar to the integrand 1 over 1 plus x squared. And because the derivative of the arctangent function is 1 over 1 plus x squared, this is the integral of this function is the arctangent function, plus c. Also called the inverse tangent function. You could write inverse tangent of x plus c. You could also write arctangent of x plus c. This is not the same as the cotangent function. It's not tangent to the negative 1 power. This means inverse function, not negative 1 power. You compare these two integrals, they are similar looking, right? These integrands. The thing that throws us for a loop here is the 4. However, the fact that I know this fact means maybe if I do an appropriate substitution, I can relate this fact to this one. And the way to see which substitution to use is to try to rewrite this integrand function as 1 over 1 plus something squared. Something in parentheses, quantity squared. Well, 4 is 2 squared, so it's going to be 2x quantity squared. And the reason that's good is now if I replace the 2x with w, say, then this integrand would be 1 over 1 plus w squared, kind of similar to this. Though there is a small price to pay in that you still have to figure out dw. If w is 2x, we've got to find dw, take the derivative of that, which is 2, and then lop on the extra dx. I want to get my integral in terms of just w. I can replace the 2x with w. I've got to replace the dx as well, though. If dw is 2dx, then dx is 1 half dw. So I do that. I replace 2x with w and replace dx with 1 half dw and go ahead and bring the 1 half in front. However, I can't stop there, right? This is a definite integral. That's an indefinite integral. This is a number. That's a family of functions with plus c's. I need to write this as a definite integral. And here's the key place people make mistakes. And here's what I want you to do. Listen carefully. I want you to change the limits of integration and never go back to x in the second method. Stick with w, never go back to x. This is actually a more important method than the first method from last Friday, especially if you take multivariable calculus, calculus 3, when doing things called double and triple integrals. Scary as that sounds, If you don't practice the way I'm about to show you, you'll be extra confused. Okay, so it's worth practicing this way. How do you change them? Use that equation. When x is 0, w will be 0 as well. 2 times 0 is 0. So in this case, the lower limit is still a 0. That doesn't always happen. I'll show you an example here in a minute where it doesn't happen. But the upper limit does change. The original upper limit is 1/2. If I find the corresponding w, I do 2 times 1/2 is 1. So I change the upper limit to a 1. You must change the upper limit to a 1 to get full credit here on this kind of problem. Stay with me for a second here. You must change it. Now, this might address your question. Some of you have done this kind of thing before. You've done substitution with definite integrals before. And what you might have done is you kept the 1/2 there, and then you went back to x. And you still got the right answer because you went back to x. I'm saying don't do that, and you will get marked points off if you do. Why? Initially in the last section, I phrased it as bad style, but it's more than bad style. It's just wrong because you'd be saying things are equal when they're not really equal. If you put 1/2 up there instead of 1, that's not an equal sign anymore, and that's bad. You would not get equality anymore at that step. You would get equality ultimately and the right answer at the end if you go back to x, but it would be a situation of two wrongs canceling to make a right. And I don't want you to do that. Okay? Does that address your question? Well, in the homework, I told you to do it like I did at the end of class on Friday, which was different than this. I said to do the antiderivative first and then use the FTC. There is a benefit to doing this change in that you never have to go back to x. This is going to be 1/2 inverse tangent of x from zero, I made the same mistake in the last class. W goes from 0 to 1, not 0 to 1/2. Sorry, that may I'm running out of space here. That's going to be 1/2 inverse tangent of 1 minus 1/2 inverse tangent of 0. These technically are inverse tangent values you should have memorized. Inverse tangent of 0 is 0. Inverse tangent of 1 turns out to be pi over 4. 45 degrees is an angle where tangent equals 1. So the final answer is pi over 8 minus 0, which is just pi over 8. So change the limits of integration when you go to the new variable and do not change back. Let's do an example where both limits of integration change. The 0 did not change here, but plenty of other examples where it does change. Let's go back to our old friend here, our first substitution problem. Integrate 2x times 1 plus x squared squared. We did this example at the end of class on Friday. Let's do the definite integral from 0 to 3. Let's do it again, but with the new method. The answer you might recall is 333. Let's see if we get the right answer. The substitution is w equals 1 plus x squared. dw is 2x dx. So you get the integral of w squared dw. The 2x and the dx combine to give you the dw. Change the limits of integration though. When x is the lower limit 0, that implies w is 1 plus 0 squared, which is 1. The lower limit becomes a 1, not a 0. When x is the upper limit 3, w is 1 plus 3 squared, which is 10. The new upper limit is 10. Now do it in terms of w and never go back to x. You get the same final answer. 10 cubed is 1,000. minus 1 is 999 over 3, which is 333. Same final answer as before. And if you had not changed the 0 and 3, if you kept them 0 and 3, you would have gotten something different and it would have been wrong. Unless you had gone back to X, but then that's bad style. Because you want to write equalities where there's really equalities. Equal signs means literally equal. It doesn't mean this is the next step. It's not like an arrow. If you're going to write equal signs, they should literally be equal.